So again, thank you for coming. I'm so glad to have Matt Suib and Nadia Hironaka here, who are the artists behind this exhibition, Dark Light. I'm just going to give a brief intro to them, and then we're going to have a conversation. We have a lot of topics we want to cover, but I also want to encourage you to jump in anytime if you have any questions or things you want to add. But first, I just want to give you a little bit of background on these two artists. Nadia and Matt are video artists based in Philadelphia, and they've been collaborators since 2008. Nadia serves as a professor and department chair at the Maryland Institute College of Art in Baltimore, Maryland. And Matt is the co-founder of Greenhouse Media, which consults artists and institutions on the planning and installation of large-scale media projects. Nadia and Matt are the recipients of several awards, including a 2015 Guggenheim Fellowship and a Pew Fellowship in the Arts. They have exhibited their work widely at venues including, and I'm going to totally slaughter this first one, Fondazione Maxi in Rome, the New Media Gallery in Vancouver, the Institute of Contemporary Art in Philadelphia, the UCLA Hammer Museum, PS1 MoMA New York, and the Philadelphia Museum of Art. So it is my pleasure to welcome Nadia and Matt back to the College of DuPage for this artist talk. And why don't you join me in giving them a warm round of applause. So how many of you have seen this show before the talk today, or had a chance to see some of the pieces? Okay, so as you know, that the exhibition is really centered around the video in the projection room, Writing History with Lightning. And in that video, the Parkway Theater in Baltimore features a prominent role. And I was just wondering if you two could explain to us how you got involved with doing the project in that space.
Sure, I'll start. And thanks, Justin. We'd like to thank Justin and the gallery for bringing us out. And thank you for making our Chicago weather actually really, really nice. So that's always a plus that we don't have like feet of snow walking around. This piece, Writing History with Lightning, began when we were commissioned by Maryland College of Art, the curatorial studies program. We're hosting an exhibition called Intersection. And it dealt with literally an intersection in Baltimore that really for the past like 50 years has kind of fallen apart. It used to be a really popular arts district about a century ago, and currently the city is trying to redevelop that location. So the focus of the topic for the exhibition was to talk about the history of that intersection and also the divide of that location as well. Previously, as an arts district, it had been thriving. Now it had fallen apart, and also it kind of marked an area where sort of the class structure in Baltimore was also divided. So we were looking at a lot of the buildings and a lot of the sort of topics that had been going on, you know, in 2015 with Freddie Gray's murder, and you know, there was a lot of hot topics going on, and we were like, how do we talk about this history that's so really, really charged at the moment? There were a lot of other artists in the exhibition. You know, we were kind of worried everyone was coming to it with the exact same kind of like focus. So when we began to think about that span, that century span, we were very aware of the Parkway Theater as a movie house being redeveloped. Right now it was in a state of decay, but it had been purchased by the Maryland Film Festival and was going to be redeveloped. And we were like, well, what were some of the major films that were showing at different periods of time in this theater? And when we were in our research, we of course discovered that the theater, which was built in 1915, was also the same year as Birth of a Nation. And suddenly we were like, okay, this is really powerful to think about that 100-year span, that century span, and we should probably do something with that film and that theater.
So just to add to that, a lot of our previous work deals with the history of cinema or specific images from the cinematic canon, of which Birth of a Nation is a major part. I mean, it was considered the first epic film of its time, and then spawned, you know, a whole new genre of epic films with casts of thousands and displays of new cinematic technology. So it was in a way that related to our previous work, that was rich material. But as Nadia mentioned, this was commissioned in 2015, which was the same year that Freddie Gray was killed in Baltimore, and Black Lives Matter sort of rose to prominence as a national movement. We approached the curators early on with an idea to make work dealing with with issues that Black Lives Matter was involved with, and specifically with the kind of nationwide protests around these issues. And the curators responded that we could do whatever we wanted, but that we should just understand that pretty much every artist that they were commissioning for this exhibition was feeling a need to deal with this kind of urgent moment and this issue, which in a way kind of challenged us to step back and push ourselves to think about it in a broad way, and understanding like the entire historical arc of their curatorial proposal, you know, looking at a century of history at this intersection in Baltimore. And that's, again, what sort of led us back to 1915, the beginning. They were looking 1915 to 2015, and giving us that range of material to work with. And so we decided to go right back to 1915 and see what was playing in movie houses in Baltimore. And really quick, the Birth of a Nation did not actually premiere in the Parkway Theater. The Parkway Theater was built in 1915. It opened just a couple of months after the film came to Baltimore. It played at a place called the Ford Theater, which if it was still standing, we would have tried to get access to that, but that building was demolished in the late 60s, I believe. The Parkway Theater in Baltimore screened the film multiple times over the last century, including when it was re-released in the 1940s with a new soundtrack. And it was, you know, we used it as something that was sort of emblematic or representative of movie houses from that era across the country where Birth of a Nation was screened.
So, you know, speaking of that film, The Birth of a Nation, and looking at you guys is, you know, how you talk about your work, and a focus of a lot of your work is to kind of counter the mythologies of our culture that are harmful, and kind of use the moving image, recontextualization of moving image, to kind of counter existing mythologies we have in culture. And that film, you know, being so controversial, beyond what you mentioned about it played a big role in the history of cinema, but kind of the story it told of the Reconstruction was very flawed. So I'm curious, specifically in the video, when you started going into the footage of the film, how you decided what scenes to use and what techniques to use to kind of counter the mythologies that were being presented in that film.
I just realized that when we say Birth of a Nation, some of you might not be familiar with this film. So mm-hmm. This film was created in 1915 by D.W. Griffith. It was a major sort of epic film, both in terms of like technology, the scenes, all of the extras, all of the characters. It was a great sort of amazing feat in cinematic history. But it's also extremely racist, and it deals and centers around sort of the Ku Klux Klan being highlighted and there's a lot of emphasis on sort of the white mythology of sort of the white populace as sort of virtuous, and that the black culture is sort of looked down upon, and that the Ku Klux Klan is again kind of put on a pedestal. So what's interesting, you know, even before we worked on this project, is that this film has caused a lot of grief throughout cinematic history, because for all of us like film professors, you have to acknowledge it, you have to talk about it. You want to acknowledge it, you definitely want to talk about it with your students, but it's this kind of weird catch where you can talk about it in terms of like the technology and at the time why it was really important and kind of interesting in terms of all that, but then also, you know, again, the propaganda that it's kind of highlighting, and of course, it's racist. So, you know, it's weird. Like, how do you show this racist film? Of course, you put it in the context of history. So, I'm going to pass over to you and talking about which like vignettes then we decided to choose.
I guess I'll back it up just a hair too to talk about our interest in cinema broadly as a kind of means of disseminating a cultural mythology. And, you know, cinema, while it's sort of in its waning days of influence, not that it will lack influence as we move forward, but it doesn't have quite the same influence it did throughout the 20th century. In the 20th century, it really was the primary vehicle for kind of cultural mythologies and for presenting the kind of stories that weave their way into the collective conscience, you know, how we understand history, how we relate to each other in the present moment. A film like Birth of a Nation, in presenting stereotypes of African Americans and of white people too, and that's one thing that I think we want to get to is is the kind of flip side of the kind of racist imagery that is shown throughout Birth of a Nation. We talk about them as mythology, but they really do impact the way that we understand history and relate to each other. Case in point is that the film, upon its release and national tour, had impacts on two national organizations that are still with us today. One is obviously the KKK, which saw a huge boom in recruiting after the film toured the country. It generated a ton of enthusiasm for this racist organization. It also, in opposition, caused a huge boom in recruitment for the NAACP, who led protests across the country against the film in, you know, outside of the theaters that it was being shown in. So there's real implications to the ways that mythologies are disseminated through cinema. And that was one of the key things that drew us to the film, is, you know, not just that we can say, oh, this is a horrible racist film, but that we can actually trace the impact of the film even to our present moment. And which is what we did, thinking about its location in Baltimore and, you know, again, the century of time between the film's release and the killing of Freddie Gray in Baltimore, and the you know, the rise of Black Lives Matter as a civil rights movement.
So then,
I don't know if I answered the question.
Actually, back to the, like, the choice of, like, what what footage to use from that film.
So, you know, it's, I mean, it's obviously, you know, very fraught subject matter, but if there is has been a moment in recent history to deal with it, I mean, now is that moment. You know, this was a conversation we had in our studio and with the curators of the exhibition for which it was commissioned. And, you know, we decided early on to dispense with the most overt stereotypes that the film presents, and there are a lot, and they are, you know, as offensive as you would expect them to be. You know, freed slaves, you know, recruited in by cynical white politicians into political positions or positions of political power, sitting in political assemblies, eating chicken off the bone. You know, I mean, really intense stuff, but. You know, I think at this present moment, we're familiar with those kinds of images and the danger that they present. So we decided not to focus specifically on those images, but to consider the actual bodies of people that were used in the film, somewhat against their will, perhaps. There are, in the film credits, there are all of the actors are credited, except for any of the African-American actors. And those are the subjects of what I consider the most intense kind of images in the piece. And they're not the only images in the piece. There, again, are images, as I mentioned, of a lot of the white characters shown representing the kind of white mythology that is displayed throughout the film. And it's, you know, this is the kind of, again, the kind of inverse of the stereotypes and the racism in the film is the elevation of the white characters, really regardless of any historical consideration, as the embodiment of a kind of American value system. You know, there's honor and loyalty and valor, and the family families of the white characters and their family relations play a very tight role. You know, all of these things are presented in a way that you don't really, you know, you wouldn't necessarily consider them in and of themselves. They're sort of the background of the film, and we just we understand that as the background of our culture, or have for the past century, because the stories have been written, you know, primarily by white men. So we focused on images that we thought represented the kind of positive stereotypes of white people, as well as images of African Americans removed from the roles in the film to some extent, or isolated in a way from the narrative or the plot line, but shown usually in groups, sitting and, you know, subject to the gaze of the camera, and in our installation to the gaze of the viewer, but not acting out a role, just, you know, perhaps they're in costume, but they're just primarily sitting. You see faces of human beings and expressions that are human. And that was sort of, in a very broad way, was what we wanted to strip away.
So you were highlighting how it's the promotion of only a positive projection of white culture juxtaposed what was an unfair negative projection of black culture at the time, how both of those stereotypes are equally as dangerous. And by highlighting that aspect in the film of the stereotype of the white culture, and then removing the scenes from the film that kind of emphasize the harmful stereotypes of black culture at the time, you're hoping to kind of highlight how fundamental those issues were, how fundamental structurally, socially, they were in the film. Is that fair?
Yeah.
And then I'm curious, you know, the big aspect of the video in the room here as well is that all the scenes from the film are actually projected on the surfaces mm-hmm. of the interior of the Parkway Theater. Now, I've had a lot of people ask me, you know, did they just do that digitally? And I know that you actually went into the space.
Mm-hmm.
And could you explain both the logistics of that, but also your thinking behind going in and actually projecting onto the walls and surfaces of the
yeah.
theater?
Yeah, I mean, for those of you that ever like to explore, go into like crumbling down buildings, it's awesome, it's amazing. I love to kind of see what junk gets left behind and like how the building starts to kind of break down and deteriorate. And we were allowed to go in. Again, Maryland Film Festival had purchased the building, but it was really, really a mess. We were even asked to wear like hard hats when we went in there. So we began to sort of explore the theater, and then you know went back for after site visits with the cameras. We had selected a series of vignettes, which we had made some that we were showing the vignettes that we had created, these little loops that were going to be shown in positive, and then some that we would invert, knowing that we would also then project them and then possibly invert that footage. So when you see the film, there'll be these moments where you'll see a positive, negative. And then we went in with basically projectors and went through and tried to project onto different spots throughout the theater where, again, there's a little bit of a push-pull or like figure ground, you know, if you guys are in some of your classes, where are you looking at the image of the little vignette, the loop that we've constructed, and or are you seeing the crumbling facade of the building? You know, which one just takes your attention? And hopefully there's a combination of both. There's a few moments where we kind of use a little bit of a trompe l'oeil, where there's like a theater scene, and there is a balcony actually in the theater that we project then all of the audience and from the film within that balcony. So there's moments that we're trying to, of course, make a direct sort of correlation and play, but other times where it's definitely off, sort of offsetting or off put. There's a bunch of guys that are kind of fighting. That's kind of projected onto a ceiling that's crumbling down. And of course, I mean, I think the metaphor maybe is a little bit obvious. Like these are old, this is an old film. These are old ways of thinking. It's projected into a building that's physically crumbling. But what does this building represent? It represents a theater space that's very, very important, where we really, you know, use a lot of these images, a lot of these films, a lot of these ideas to influence the way that we think. I mean, without you probably even realizing it, there's moments, you know, in your life that you think about that come from your being informed through cinema, you know, oh, that moment of the first kiss, oh, you know, a car crash scene, oh, this. I mean, a lot of these images instantly play out in our mind in a very Hollywood sort of sensibility. You know, so when you see this film, you know, especially if you saw it back in the day, it's definitely going to influence one's thinking. So the power structure of the theater itself, you know, takes a lot, has a big presence, and plays a character within our piece. You know, there's some interesting thing. One fact that we just like discovered a couple of days ago watching this documentary film, The 13th, on I think it was on Netflix, right? On Netflix. Mm-hmm. But like, you know, talking about how influential films can be, and one of the comments in this film is like, life really does imitate art, which I did not know this, but apparently the Ku Klux Klan using the burning cross did not exist before Birth of a Nation. So Birth of a Nation, D.W. Griffith did this purely for as a device, right? You know, it's dramatic, it's really important, it's really impactful, his burning cross. And he used that for the film. And it was after the film that Ku Klux Klan members actually thought that was so great and kind of continued on with that.
Well, I think that also points to another aspect about this exhibition at this moment. You know, this idea of like the power of film or media to kind of create something for its own purposes that actually then goes out into culture mm-hmm. on its own on control. And so, you know, you made this video in 2015, and obviously it was in reaction to a lot of the events of that year, specifically in Baltimore. But I'm wondering how you view it now in 2017, considering the recent history of the country between that point and now. And has it changed at all about how you view the film or the, you know, the exhibition?
Sure. Yeah. Although I want to back up and just tackle on a little bit to what Nadia said, which is, you know, she mentioned that the theater is a sort of structure of power and authority, and that was actually like something that really was quite essential to the piece, you know, to project it back onto the surface of the venue in which it was presented publicly. Because theaters, cinema sort of lends its authority to these kinds of images. You know, they project it out into the world to a public, and the very fact of the kind of architecture in which it's shown is a reinforcement of the ideas, you know, in the narratives that are shown. It has authority because it's on the big screen. You know, we have a president who is a guy on TV, you know, and there was a governor of California who was a guy from the movies. You know, we, as a culture, put huge stock in these kinds of popular images, and the theater reinforces that. And so it gets to the idea of the structures of racism, the structures that bolster a racist ideology and culture. And one of the things also that's mentioned, I think, in the gallery notes is that Birth of a Nation was the first film screened in the White House. And it was screened for Woodrow Wilson in 1915 when it came out, and assembled politicians and Supreme Court justices, which is rather shocking. You know, and if you haven't seen the film and you decide to watch it, keep that in mind as you watch it, that this was the first film shown in the White House to a sitting president. And you know, here we are 100 years later, and there's you know, quite a bit of discussion. I don't want to get too sidetracked, and I certainly can go off, but there's a lot of discussion about racial politics in the new administration, and a particular history, you know, with the president, or current president. But it, you know, with well,
however, though, in 2015 when we made it, you know, we had our first black president. So you know, we were also looking at that shift in the 100-year span of right. like, oh, this is really interesting. There's a lot that's changed, and then issues with Freddie Gray, and there's a lot that hasn't. So it was, you know, definitely an interesting century to think about and talk about in terms of like the race, you know, the race clash, basically. Sorry. Continue.
Oh, what's the question again?
No, I was just curious how, you know, and she kind of talked about how it's changed since
yeah.
the 2 years since.
I mean, I think there, you know, we felt an urgency when we made it. It was, you know, again, it was made in the year that that Black Lives Matter rose as a national organization, and we saw, you know, a number of young black men killed, you know, and there's a lot of discussion to have around that, but what we're looking at are the kind of the underpinnings, you know, how this kind of you know, structural racism, you know, how we live it, not even knowing it or not even aware of it, you know, that we think was an urgent issue at the moment, and we feel like there's a renewed urgency to showing it. We've been, you know, wanting to get this work out into the world as much as possible, and it's, you know, not the kind of you know, entertaining museum experience that, you know, some people might be looking for, but which we, you know, we are not always political artists. You know, we're not our MO is not always to go straight for political messages. A lot of the work that we enjoy is, you know, totally objective, or I should say, you know, non-objective, abstract, experimental work. But we felt that there, you know, there are moments where there's an urgency to making this kind of work, and we have a, we're fortunate enough to have a platform to do it, and so that, you know, we want to use that to, you know, sort of facilitate a discussion.
So it seems even more timely,
yeah.
you know. unfortunately, seems even more timely. You know, something, and I've noticed too, just seeing different people in the gallery, both when we were installing and even today, you know, when you walk out of that space, it's pretty, pretty pitch black in there. And when you walk out, you know, the intention with then the fluorescent lights for the intensity is to have, when you come out of that space, it should hurt a little bit. I mean, it should be a little blinding, and I notice everyone comes out and it's like, you know, it's intense. That's really intentional. You know, it's intentional to have this kind of in your face, low ceiling of fluorescent lights that kind of force you to just feel, you know, to deal with the brightness of, you know, what is lit, how do you exist in this space, how do you kind of contemplate this emphasis between that dark space, you know, what you just watched, walking into this brightly lit gallery.
I think that it's good to talk about the intentional decisions made with the installation in the gallery. I think especially for a lot of students, younger artists, I think maybe people have a tendency to come in and see an exhibition like this where they're not familiar with seeing 30 fluorescent lights hung 7 feet off the ground, and the impulse might be to dismiss or, you know, discount it as some sort of like just contemporary folly or whatever. But I think that talking about not only the intentionality of this installation relationship to the video, how people automatically have to walk into it, how it's a contrast to it, how it affects how you view the photos in this space, but also the other aspects of the video we haven't talked about, like the audio. I think the one piece that really dominates the whole space, and at times the lobby when the show's open, is the soundtrack to the video. Now, I know some of it was taken from the original, mm-hmm. but I know that you altered it in different ways, too. I'm wondering if you could explain how you altered it and if you even added things to it.
Yeah, so, I mean, so we worked with the original audio that was used for Birth of a Nation. It's been manipulated a lot.
You should back it up a little bit, because it was a silent film that would be played in theaters with live accompaniment in 1915, but it had a theatrical re-release in the 40s with a soundtrack, which is what you will find on a, you know, on a Blu-ray disc today, or
and how most people, I'd say, you know, that I know, you know, have come to know that film. So we worked with that soundtrack and did a lot of manipulation to it. I mean, the idea is that it is altered, that it has been adjusted, that it has been manipulated. So there's a lot of filters and effects. You know, there's times when the audio slowed down. A lot of times when it's played in reverse. There's also moments in the footage itself where it's in reverse. So the shots of the Klan's member on the horses, for example, is actually going in reverse. Even though they're galloping seemingly forward, they're really galloping in reverse. And then in addition to that audio, there's other some sound effects, and also there is a live feed from during the Baltimore uprisings after Freddie Gray. We had audio from the police, I guess the police receivers that were kind of going back and forth. So you're hearing some chants, you're hearing some people, you're hearing the police officers also on the walkie-talkies. So we're using that soundtrack because, again, in a lot of ways, there's almost like this, you know, third person, or the building itself has a lot of presence, the parkway. And the parkway having existed for such a long period of time, we forget about the presence of the building and, you know, that the memory kind of that the building itself takes on. So to have been erected in 1915, you know, having this period, you know, and also during the year of Birth of a Nation, and then 100 years later, you know, being witnessed, really, because all of this was going on right outside the doors of the parkway. Of course, it was closed down, but having the uprising, having the protests happening right outside the door. So the building, you know, itself, although it speaks of a great past, it also exists currently in the present. So what do you, you know, how do you think about these kind of structures and these institutions? And there's also a big clash intentionally with the look and the feel of the kind of the style of these, you know, great theaters of the, you know, early 20th century in opposition or in contrast from something like the fluorescent light. So, you know, think about this institution or other institutions that you're walking into. What is the decoration? What is the lighting scheme? How do you place emphasis on those institutions, right? Everything becomes justified. Something's in a museum, in a gallery, in a theater space, instantly it's sort of been given credit, right? Somebody has signed off on it, you know, libraries, all of that. So it's just something to think about, like what you kind of just sort of assume or what you actually stop and think about, like why is that, you know, of interest or of importance, all of that. Sorry, that kind of,
that's
all of that. You know,
are there any questions or comments thus far? I mean, I think it's, you know, one of the things we, you know, want to do is facilitate a kind of discussion. So again, feel free to raise your hand at any point and challenge us. And, you know, I want to make it clear that, you know, while it's an important issue and it's important, we felt it was important in our, you know, our studio practice to think about this and approach it, that you know, that I'm a white man. I'm not an authority on on many aspects of the politics around this issue. You know, one of the things that we're hoping to do is to, you know, to talk to people whose experiences also are different than ours, and you know, really understand as many points of view as possible. So I just want to put that out there again, and that, you know, if anyone has questions or comments as we're talking, just raise your hand or chime in and interrupt.
Can you address kind of the relationship of the photos that you've chosen to put to the gallery to the video installation, as well as the relationship to the lights? Because I think, you know, this is the thing that you see when you walk into the gallery space, mm-hmm. first, in many ways, but then you're directed to it. So just kind of your thoughts around that.
So, I mean, one of the things, obviously, the fluorescent lights blast everything, right? So, I mean, you walk by, it's super, super bright, but probably at not too far of a distance, all you're seeing are black rectangles, right? You can't really make out much detail at a distance, you know, too far when you're walking by. Part of that, too, is, you know, obviously we shot these in the theater with very, very pretty much low light or the ambient light that was in the space. But also to kind of get you to kind of realize, like initially, just sort of formally, I like this sort of idea of this void on the wall. But then the details only surface as you start to get closer and as your eyes start to adjust. So it takes a moment. It's very intentionally not to be an easy read. You have to spend a little bit of time. You have to kind of get a little bit closer, and you have to have time to adjust.
If you look at the photographs first, or if you see the film first, you know, you'll recognize their place. Not every single one, but almost all of them are spots that were projected on. You know, we projected images on and re-recorded. So they're, in a way, these photographs are like characters. They're, you know, or headshots or production stills from, you know, in a traditional Hollywood way, like you would produce a series of production stills. You'd have headshots of your talent, you know, your lead actors for a film. So these also sort of function in that way. But yeah, they were shot in the available light of the theater, which was no light, basically, except for a little light filtering in through a glass door. I think we brought one light with us just to kind of like, because it really was, there were some very pitch black corners of the space. But yeah.
Were you also sort of thinking about the light of the space reflecting off of the surfaces? Being reflective, sort of thing.
Not precisely. In a way that, yeah, it was a thing that sort of, we understood the possibility of that happening, but it wasn't really a calculated part of the piece. I mean, in fact, we have sort of anti-reflective glass in front of the photos. It would be difficult to see the images without it. But the, you know, what Nadia described about the coming out of the theater, the screening space, into this room and having this very intense light that almost hurts your eyes, also works in the reverse. Okay, so if you come in into this space and you spend time here first and you see the light boxes on the walls, which are sort of referencing like a cinematic marquee, and you know, in this overhead piece. You then walk into a really dark space, which is far, far darker than it is after you spend 5 minutes in there and your eyes adjust. There's something called light adaptation and dark adaptation. It's just a physiological process of your pupils dilating and your, you know, how your eye perceives light. And that was something we have worked with before and think about in relations, you know, to this specific piece, which the images that are projected are very dark. You know, they're hard to make out even after you've, some of them are difficult to make out what you're actually looking at after you've been in there for a few minutes, but even more so when you first enter the space. So this, the light in this space, and this is all of the light boxes and the fluorescent fixtures comprise a piece called Bright White Light. That's the ground by which we view everything in this gallery. You know, there's nothing that's not affected by these lights. Turn them off and, you know, whatever light comes in through the window, I suppose, you know, you can make out some of the photographs, but you really need more light than that to see them. And then again, they walking in and out of the theater, there's a physical impact that that has. So we're trying to, we're, you know, thinking about a way to translate the metaphor of, or to use, you know, structural racism as a sort of metaphor. I mean, how can that be expressed through a physical, physiological reaction?
I think that before we open up to more questions, because we're getting close to the end here, you know, there's been a lot of different reaction to the show. You know, I think that a lot of people who've come in, read the information, spent time with it. There's been a lot of good conversations that come up, but there's also a lot of people who are just like, why do this? You know, what's the importance of this? Why? Because it's difficult. You know, the video, I think for a lot of visitors to the gallery, it's not pleasant to sit through, like you said, the combination of it being in that dark space, the content, the ominous music, you know, it is not a entertainment experience. It's challenging, and it deals with, you know, some of the more difficult issues that we face as a culture at a time when those are present at a lot of levels that I think people have a little bit of exhaustion. Do you know what I mean? So I'm curious, as artists, you know, talking to the students and young artists here, what do you see the importance of keeping the focus on or bringing a different perspective on those issues that aren't always easy to address, that aren't always pleasant, that aren't always about just making something nice and entertaining?
Well, I mean, you know, I think actually it's the artist Bill Viola, if you guys are familiar with the video artist Bill Viola, who talked about like what ultimately he wanted to do with art or what was important for him with art. And I always thought it was really an excellent way of put it is that for him, like the best art inspires thought, period. So if you're looking at something and it does absolutely nothing for you, fine, but I would say that for me would be work that isn't very successful. If you're thinking about it, if it actively engages you somehow and you want to know more, or you know, or maybe you don't even enjoy it that much, but it makes you think, then it demands some attention. You know, we all are living, thinking people, and you know, our brains want to be activated. We want to kind of be engaged in certain questions and discussions. I mean, that's what we're here for. I mean, in terms of like why, I mean, it's tricky. You know, I think as an artist, you know, maybe as a historian or a curator, someone can take that on more specifically. I think as an artist, it's because that was something I felt drawn to do. You know, I was moved to make a piece. I'm moved to make art. That's what I want to do. I mean, it's, you know, I think it's sort of justified in the action.
I think that it's the first historical moment. Well, it's a historical moment in the discussion around race, and that we have two, I think, really powerful terms that have emerged in kind of public discourse around racism that I think a lot of people are unfamiliar with. They're not new terms, but they're, I think, new to a kind of mainstream discourse, and that's structural racism, which I've, you know, already mentioned several times, and white privilege. And they're both, you know, white privilege is sort of the flip side of racism and of stereotyping, you know, by the dominant culture or majority. They're difficult concepts, I think, for a lot of people to come to terms with and to understand. So in my thinking, that was part of the rationale for making this piece and trying to get it out into the world. is to understand, you know, my own place in the equation. You know, being a white male, you know, having, you know, comes with a certain amount of privilege. And I mean, I'm even privileged to have a platform here, you know, at a gallery halfway across the country from where I live and work. And, you know, that it isn't, I think the art world, you know, I think there's a lot of discussion about this, and I think there's a lot of really interesting discussion about difficult topics. And I feel like, you know, we have a limited audience, but it's an audience, and we can try to push a discussion forward. And I think it's important to, you know, I think this is a moment where we can make work that deals with these terms and try to further some understanding of it.
And also to take back a little bit of possibility to think about history and memory and how we explore what we have already believed to exist as is and revisit that. I mean, visual studies came about, I don't know, probably, was it the 80s or 90s? I mean, you know, I'm just thinking of, you know, the idea of readdressing and looking back at periods of the past that are no longer fixed in one way of how we view them. We go back and we look at, like, what it does, I mean, in this art context, what exists in the museums, you know, what were considered really important works back in the 1700s or the 1600s and why, and are those the same works that were important in the 1800s, you know, and so now it's not fixed anymore. We are constantly revisiting and re-examining what has gained importance at different points of time throughout history, and it changes.
Well, I really appreciate it based on the fact that I think that often when we face difficult discussions, they're avoided because people don't want to go somewhere they know is going to be difficult and hard to talk about. But I think repeatedly, we're being confronted with situations where the lack of a discussion, the lack of facing these issues is coming, rising up, you know, and through all different forms, through different animosities or resentments. And so whatever platform that exists, using that to kind of address these conversations that people don't necessarily want to have but should have, I think is valuable. So I appreciate it, and that's why we're having the show in the space. But we've talked about a lot of things here. I mean, about the intentionality of installation, about the video construction, about a lot of current politics of film, you know, structural institutions. And I'm just wondering what everyone thinks or what has to say. So I just want to open it up to everybody here. If you have any questions for Matt and Nadia about anything they talked about, any other aspect that we didn't cover about the show.
So you'll have to forgive my lack of knowledge about other work you guys have done, but is installation a form that you typically use, or is this a little bit outside of the norm for?
We typically do a lot of work with installation. My background is with film, so I went to both undergrad and graduate school for film specifically. And I say film, it's funny, I don't mean video, I went for film. Nowadays, it's the same. But and Matt went to school for photography. Only that in context of saying, you know, we tend to work mainly with a moving image. And at times we're doing pieces that are single channel, so maybe, you know, usually short form, so, you know, works that you're gonna see at a film festival, most likely. Or it will be presented, you know, projected in a space that's meant to be shown looped, you know, in a gallery. But often we're doing pieces that are more installation driven. So there might be five different projections, maybe even overlapping each other, that span over the entire surface. We've done some very large projections, like on buildings that are, you know, three or four stories tall. So installation is a form that we enjoy a lot because it tends to be very immersive. It really, you know, it physically kind of takes on a space, and when you're in that space, it's kind of hard to sometimes maybe separate yourself because you're physically immersed within it.
Yeah, go ahead.
So regarding your art taking into account that it makes people think about certain issues, mm-hmm. Do you think that that's more impactful for people to really take issues like that seriously because say like the video is bringing out their emotions, whereas if somebody were to just talk to them about it, they might feel like they're getting views pushed on them instead. It's more of an organic way of thinking about the issue, I guess.
Well, I mean, you know, images are incredibly powerful, and this is, I think, where, you know, we can talk a lot about, like, the audience for contemporary art. You know, it's a sliver of the population at large, you know, but...
it's a great sliver.
It's a great sliver.
It's a good sliver.
It's, I mean, it's, but it's, you know, it's also, they're people, nonetheless, and they're people who talk to other people, you know, I mean, and there are people who also make things, you know, so that, you know, that work shown even in the most experimental confines of a contemporary art context can ripple out into culture in, I think, in surprising ways sometimes. You know, you'll read about a Hollywood filmmaker who was really influenced by some experimental filmmaker you never heard of. So, but, you know, images are really powerful. I mean that's the power of Birth of a Nation, you know, and that's why it's such a dark chapter in cinematic history and American history, because it really helped to fix images, very ugly stereotypes, in a very, you know, what we can see now very overtly, you know, overt dark stereotypes in the kind of collective conscience, you know. And you can, as I mentioned before, you can trace a line between the way that Gus, who is one of he's the sort of antagonist in the film. He's a freed slave who's stalking a white woman, the daughter of a prominent white politician. How that, you know, you can project that forward decades into a presidential election where a Republican candidate used an ad of a man named Willie Horton, who was released from prison on a program by the Democratic presidential candidate at the time, Michael Dukakis. He had been in prison for rape and murder and was released after spending most of his life in prison, and was released on good behavior, but then wound up committing another crime. And George H.W. Bush used this ad with a very prominent image of Willie Horton, a black, you know, rapist, basically, to build upon this kind of stereotypical image that that people, Americans, have carried with them since Birth of a Nation. You know, this character, which was a complete fiction and fabrication in the film, is so powerful that it rests in the subconscious of many Americans who fear others, and that ripples into everyday lives and politics and actually sways elections, because that campaign ad is widely credited with being one of the most successful ever and played a huge part in sinking the candidacy of the Democratic candidate at the time, based around this single image.
But actually, I mean, Matt's sort of answering almost what, you know, I would say poetry. I mean, so there's something about the poetics of how you use art to get ideas and messages and thoughts across. So versus someone standing up, I mean, we're kind of not lecturing, but, you know, we're having a conversation here. But that's one way of getting information. It hopefully in most lectures and stuff, or news, it's supposed to be factual and all of that, right? It's given in a very direct form. There are a lot of artists who do work that is very, very direct. You know, there's no way you're going to misinterpret or be confused about the message. For us, though, I mean, I think our message is clear, I think the way you come to understand it, or how you come to it or enjoy it, is speaking and using the terms and craft of art. You know, there's form, there's the craft of filming, there's the editing. You know, these are all elements that we really enjoy and like to use in getting ideas and messages across. So, I mean, so I would say it's the poetics of cinema and filmmaking that we really enjoy, as well as obviously the content.
All right, well, I think Matt and Nadia will be here for a while and hang out if you guys want to ask them anything, and check out the rest of the show. We can start the video up again. But I want to thank you both for coming to the gallery and talking with us.